Hey, this is Kirk.
And this is Byrd. It's the Kirk and Byrd Show. And we are honored to have our, I would say our most famous, our greatest guest of all time. We got the legendary Coach Mike Smith. Coach Smith was the coach of the Hampton High School Crabbers for 51 years, won over 500 games, I believe 506, during those 51 years, 12 state championships, okay, and third all-time in high school wins. We are honored to have you, Coach Smith. Thank you very, very much for being with Kirk and Byrd.
Thanks for inviting me. I'm looking forward to the conversation.
Yeah.
Great.
So, Coach, you're down on Buckrow Beach in our hometown, and you retired. You're not going to be going back in the fall, so it's going to be an adjustment for you. But we thank you for the opportunity. You know, Rusty and I grew up in Hampton, going to those great Hampton Crabber games, the Hampton Bethel games, and Hampton always going to the playoffs at Todd Stadium and buying tickets at Old Point Bank, sold out by Tuesday. But we want to take it back because, you know, a lot of folks, usually the high points are covered with you, you know, the number of wins, the great players, the tradition, your third nationally. But you're from part of the country that my folks are from, not exactly Pennington Gap, but you went to Pennington Gap High School. Let's talk about where you grew up and, you know, growing up in Southwest Virginia, kind of cold country. Tell us a little bit about that, Coach.
Well, actually, I wasn't in cold country, although there was cold country surrounding us. I was born in Anderson, Indiana. Came to Virginia when I was 8 years old, I guess. My parents moved back into the locality where we were. My father worked for the Tennessee Eastman with the Holston Defense, which was a part of the Tennessee Eastman. Mm-hmm. And my mother was a nurse at Holston Valley Hospital, Kingsport, Tennessee. So, I mean, that was early on. Later on, she was a nurse at there was a clinic in Pennington Gap. But I grew up with a elementary school in Stickleyville. We always got around May the 5th. Always so excited, walk home. At that time, it was a gravel road up about 3 miles. But my feet were so tough, it didn't make any difference by the end of the summer. Never, I don't think I ever put shoes back on until I had to go back to school. Used to fish and hunt. That was my love of life at that time. And started playing football in the eighth grade, and that became my first love.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So when you played football, Coach, when you started out, what positions were you playing? And did you love it right away? And before you actually put on those pads, is it something that, you know, I grew up just playing in the yard. And if you were out there, when did you start? Did you just know right away this was my game, or was it when you finally put the pads on?
Well, I didn't have the privilege of being introduced to football like you guys were. I remember the first football game I saw on TV was, I think it was Michigan and Illinois. And I was over at my aunt's house and came on and I liked that, you know, I liked that very much. Mm-hmm. But my first introduction to playing football was when I was in the eighth grade. And you could play in the eighth grade at that time. And I went out for football and I was at a picture of me standing under Patrick. Well, he was the biggest guy we had on the team. He was 6'5", 300-pound, Pat Carter.
Right.
Okay.
The largest and the smallest. I think in the eighth grade, But that was no face mask, mind you.
Really? Oh, wow.
No face mask. Okay. So the first I learned was that when they lined up over in front of you, first thing you learned to look for was an elbow coming for your nose. 3 days, my nose looked like Pinocchio.
Right.
So that was some rough football. Then we had high top shoes, aluminum cleats, which were they probably a half inch long, but after a while they would get worn on the hard dirt we were playing on.
Right.
A lot of grass, kind of like Hampton High School field in the old days. But those things
were
razor blades. I still have scars on my shins, but a little over a week into it. I woke up one morning, and I said, I was mentally beat, physically beaten. It beat me up. My nose was swollen. My legs were sore. My mom came and woke me up. Well, first of all, my mom said, "You play football, I'm never coming to a game because you're going to get hurt." I said, "Mom, I'll be fine." So that morning she came to get me, and she had to drive me to practice, which was about 8 to 10 miles. And said, "Time to go." I said, "I'm not going. I'm going to give it up." She said, "Oh, no, you're not. you started, you're going to finish."
That's good.
Wow. So
from that day on, it never entered my mind again. I was okay. But I was still beaten up when I was in eighth grade. By the ninth grade, I'd kind of gotten through that. I can remember the old days, though, with those old long cleats. You get groin pulls every year. No water.
Yep.
It was a sin to ask for a drink of water.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely could not have a drink of water. So we would slip around and find the analgesic bomb and eat a little bit of that. That stuff was pretty rough, but it was a lot better than cotton mouth.
Yep.
It was interesting. Those were tough days.
What position did you play, Coach?
Well, I played offensive guard and linebacker.
Okay.
Played a little bit of quarterback, but I was predominantly my love was playing linebacker. I was kind of like any linebacker. I like old Melendez. What did you play?
I played a fullback at Bethel. Melendez was the linebacker, and he played a little running back.
Yeah. That's kind of like I was. I loved it. I just something about the magnet pulled me to it. My brother, who's 14 months younger than me, was a year behind me in school. He was a running back and a defensive back. And I never forget one day I broke his fingers in practice. he was a tough one, though. But anyhow, that's where I was. Got a face mask in the ninth grade.
Okay.
Got a face mask attached to the helmet, and it sit on your chin, and it sit on your nose, and like the mask that you saw, Lecter in the Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah.
You had to actually unhook your chin strap, flip it up to breathe between plays.
Wow.
And that was in the ninth grade. And then the 10th grade had a Wilson helmet with a single bar across it.
Oh, you were the man.
But I died you were going the to heaven, buddy.
Yeah, boy.
That was great.
Yeah.
We never had anything like a mask that was similar to today.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Now, Coach, we had talked before. So my mom grew up in Wise, Virginia, which I told you I was there this past weekend. God's country down there, not far from Pennington Gap and Sticklerville. But so my cousin by marriage is Carol Dale, and my uncle, Bill Wampler, played for J.J. Kelly. They're a little bit older than you, but you said you played against them, which is...
I don't know. I played with Carol Dale.
Yeah?
Wow.
Yeah, Carol Dale. I was in the 10th grade. No, I was in... I think I might have been in the 10th grade.
Mm-hmm.
Carol Dale was a senior, either 9th or 10th. We go up and play them at J.J. Kelly High School.
Yep.
I never forget, we went back into the halftime. Our place of deployment was to the shop, with a woodworking shop.
Right.
That's where we went. We were tied 10-10. And we had a quarterback by the name of, what was that boy's name? But he was very tough. I know we had some Rastniks that played with us.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't him. But anyhow, he was quite a player. And we were 10-10. But second half, we got beat down. Pat Carter was a big boy. We had a kid named Joe Teague that went to Kentucky.
Oh, wow.
Black Collier, he ended up his freshman year having too much fun. Blanton Collier said he could have been the best he'd ever been. So they sent him back home. He left going to Texas, man. And then he had Teague's funeral home up in Charlottesville.
Hmm.
Just up on the hill as you go out of past campus there. So it was weird. But they had some tough guys up at UVA Wise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm trying to think of the old big running back they had that was so tough. He was a bad dude, man. He'd give you a headache every time you hit him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember Carol Dale, and Carol used to come after he played with the Packers. My dad, and when my daddy retired, he purchased 100 acres there nearby where we used to live. And Carol Dale used to come down, and he and my dad would grouse hunt together. Mountain pheasant, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Those are back in the days where the guys worked in the summer, or the summertime. So he came back from Green Bay and had a job because money in the NFL wasn't like it is now.
He was there one time they didn't pay football players.
Yeah. Yep. He sold sports things to convenience stores and all that back in Bristol back in the day. But so, Coach, you finished up and then you started your higher education at East Tennessee State. Is that right?
I went from there to Lincoln Memorial University.
Right.
Oh, okay.
I decided I wanted to go to I was over at ESTU when Starwood was rocking in his chair. Some of my friends actually ended up coaching up here, Charlie Hollis.
Oh, yeah. Tab.
And Bowling Shoot, who was over at Bethel.
Right.
Yeah, Shoot.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Shoot. Shoot and I started coaching together at Hampton High School. And then they opened Bethel High School. Shoot goes over, gets the job. Try to steal all our players from Hampton.
It started back early.
I hate to talk about my buddy, and he's deceased, but he was a spec. And and so I went down, and I transferred there, and then some of my friends from LMU went to East Tennessee State to play baseball. Old Pete out of her and some of the guys. But it was really amazing when I started coaching up here. Charlie Hovis who was over there at East Tennessee, but he was from Kingsport.
Mm-hmm.
Then my mom called me and said, do you know a guy named Charlie Hobus up there? I said, I sure do. I said, he's coaching at York at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then he ended up being the head coach at Tab also.
Right.
She said, well, I work with his sister at Houghton Valley. She's a nurse. So later on down the road, we were redoing Darling Stadium, rebuilding a new one. And we were playing some games up at York Field, but had to go to York to scout a game. And I look over and I see Charlie Hobus. I said, Charlie was a good friend of mine, loved him to death. And then all of a sudden I see Charlie down 20 yard line. I said, he better get back up. He gonna get played. Then I see him back up at the 50. Then I see him at the 25. What's he doing? Then I got to looking, there was two Charlie Hobuses over there. I didn't realize he had a twin brother come up and get on the sideline.
You thought somebody spiked your water.
Oh, I didn't know what it was. I hadn't had anything to drink for. Maybe I need some corrective vision correction.
Now, Coach, didn't you spend some time in Richmond? You told me. MCV or VCU?
I went to MCV and I was going to medical school. Actually, I was going to dental school with the first year you could option out and go out of the way with. But man, then I felt it's like a call of the wild. I kept hearing football. So I went back, came here. I had a friend here named Tom Tiller that I played with in high school and young college with. He was here coaching Thorpe Junior High School at that time.
Thorpe, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And his uncle was assistant superintendent. His mom had started the credit union here. So they were real good friends. So I packed up, came up here. And then I was, the next year I was offered a job at Churchill, Tennessee. Okay. And of course, I was an assistant coach that first year, but I stayed and then started coaching here. And
mm-hmm.
the only time I was going to leave, I was coaching with the best guy in the world, a guy named Johnny Palmer.
Yep.
Johnny was from AC Glass High School in Lynchburg, mm-hmm. played at Duke. Was assistant coach at Newport News. Got the job at Hampton, and actually Shoop and I went with him or joined him that mm-hmm. first year.
What year was that, Coach?
What year,
do you remember? 64?
I went there in 1964 in February, so that's 66. And so we go there, and Shoop ends up going in 68, maybe, to Bethel.
That's when Bethel opened, yep.
Started yeah, I was pro. Going. And then we go down the road a little bit, and they offered me the job at Pembroke.
Right.
So I was like 20. 9 years old, and I thought I was ready to whip the world. So I signed me a contract with Pembroke. I was going to ride next year. So Johnny came to me and he said, Coach, stay with me. He said, don't leave me. He said, I'll give you my coaching supplement and he was assistant basketball coach. I gave my assistant basketball coach supplement too.
I said, wow.
Johnny, I love you. I love you, buddy. I love you like a father, but I want to spread my wings. I was still young and stupid at that time. I've gotten a little bit smarter, but yeah, I went ahead and signed a contract. And he comes to me and he said, well, if you're leaving, I'm leaving. They had already flown people up here from Lynchburg and offered him the job at EC Glass.
Mm-hmm.
He told him he was going to stay here. And then he said, well, look, I'm going to tell him I'm coming down there. So he called him up and he went. And then I had to go through the process of principal, oh, you were. But he was a good guy. I sweated that weekend, man. Maybe the weekend and the next week. But then I got the job. And been there ever since. I mean, it just kind of became part of my life.
So, Coach, that was 1970? Is that correct?
1970.
All right.
In 1960, we had won the state championship, which was, you didn't go through the playoffs. You played one game. They were two in the regions, the mm-hmm. top regions. We played Great Bridge, Billy O'Brien, who mm-hmm. was late.
Great program, yeah.
Delegates and at Great Bridge. And so we played them, and they had a running back. Name slips my mind, but he was going to had signed with LSU.
Ooh.
And he got on TV and said, well, you know, they're a good football team, but they're 10 years behind us over on the peninsula. But when it was over, we were 42 points ahead of them. We beat them 42 to nothing. But
wow.
We had a guy named Bruce Bassenberg, which was both ways All-State. Offensive mm-hmm. defense, played offensive guard and linebacker. And he and Barty Smith and Douglas Freeman were the only two guys in the state that were first team All-State both ways. That's when you only had division, class 3A, 2A, and 1A.
Right.
Coach, so let me ask you something. I know you, because the years I was at Bethel, you know, playing in 84, 85, 86, you guys had some big clashes with T.C. Williams in the state championship. But when I think of T.C. Williams, we live in Northern Virginia now. I lived in Alexandria for a number of years. Now I'm in Woodbridge. And there was a movie called Remember the Titans. And that team, I think, won the state championship in 1970 or 71. And 71. They're telling us 71. And they're telling the story of integration. So, Coach, can you tell me, did you guys have any issues with integration at Hampton? Were you there at that time? And how did it go? Was it kind of like that movie? Was it smooth or what?
We were already involved, you know, and the people in Hampton lived so closely together, the black people and the white people and whatever the rest of us are. I don't know what the hell I am, but it was, there was never a problem.
Right.
But we, in 1969, after we beat a Great Bridge, we'd end up winning 29 games in a row.
Wow.
And they decided they were going to play the playoffs through. And we were looking forward to it. But that was the last year that what's called Turkey Day game was Hampton and New News was played.
Yeah.
Big rivalry. Big rivalry.
Yeah, we've been beating them pretty good. And they were like 6-3 or something like that. But they had a guy named JoJo Bethay and another named Willie Armstead that
mm-hmm.
came over
wow.
from
wow.
Huntington.
Right.
JoJo Bethay wow. ended up going to Clemson, played basketball. Willie Armstead went to University of Utah and then played in Canadian League for years as a tight end. But long story short, we go into the game. And we might as well have been playing on the moon that day. It was Thanksgiving Day. They hadn't even kicked an extra point all year. They kicked a field goal, and we're behind 10-7 at just 20-some seconds before the half. No, actually, we were only, I think, 7. It was 7-0. And 7-3. And just before the half, 21 seconds, they kicked the ball off to us. They kicked the field goal, made it 7-3. They kicked the ball off. And Johnny Palmer, we were on. It's the first game that Johnny and I ever coached together. I wasn't upstairs. We didn't have any phones down
there. Okay.
At Newport News. So I'm down on the field. He sends Jimmy Williams in, told him to run the flare pass. And we're back on about the 10-yard line. I said, no, don't do that. Let's wait till halftime. We'll come back. We got a problem. We'll solve it. And anyhow, he was the head coach, so he insisted. We threw the pass to JoJo, but they picked it off, ran in the end zone. And the game ends up 10-7.
Wow.
And we hadn't given up 10 points all year.
Right.
But that might have been the longest day in football I ever encountered in my life. I went home and watched Texas and Oklahoma play that day. And I thought, geez, why am I involved with this? But, wow. At the end of the game, Johnny said he's even said it's all yours, coach. And a couple of weeks later, he was ready to talk about next year.
Wow.
So I go to Pembroke. But eventually, I ended up at Hampton. So.
Yeah. Coach, I was blessed to have played in the Hampton-Bethel rivalry. I played in 3 of those games, 84, 85, and 86. We played you guys twice in that fall of 84. We beat got you the first time. Beat you the first time. That's right. Yep. I think I might be when we
run it back.
Rodney Howard. Man, yeah. And look, both teams were loaded. Y'all had Linwood Lumpkins. You have a distant relative of mine, Leslie Bailey. I mean, a lot of my friends from youth football, Craig Overton. Oh, man, just so many great players. But I want to ask you, that was my first time being on the sideline. For years, I was just a kid in the stands. It's what made me love football. But can you tell us a little bit about that Hampton-Bethel rivalry? I know it got going in the 70s. Maybe tell us a little bit about if you have a game that sticks out or just your rivalry with Coach Coz. Because, I mean, you look back and back then, if you could just survive the Peninsula District, you would win the state championship.
Boom.
Like, you know? And so tell us about that, Coach.
Well, I think Bethel won a couple of them. But it started out with Shute. And I think one of my outstanding games for Shute was when he had we were playing him one night. He had a kid that went to Duke and played quarterback.
Is it Mike Dunn?
Mike Dunn.
Okay.
So I'm playing Shute. I get down on the goal line. Shute already ran a gap 8, you know. So I knew I could run a dump pass on with a tight end. But every time we throw it, there's a defensive back at. So after our Peninsula season was over, and neither of us went to the playoffs that year. Shoop and I were going up to Fredericksburg to watch Gate City. And the team in Fredericksburg.
Might be Chancellorsville. I'm trying to think. No. Okay.
One Chancellorsville. It's the one that's been there longer. But anyhow, we're driving down the road. That's 1966, 67, so it's hard to remember all that. Shoop says, "How'd you like my defense?" I said, "That's good, Shoop. I couldn't figure out how in the world you ended up with a safety with all those people up in the line of scrimmage, stop the run." He started giggling. He said, "Go back and count the people." He took out two and put in three. He had 12.
There you go.
Oh, Coach Shoop, my man.
Shoop was slick, boy. He get you. He gets you every time. But with Coz, I think one of my best memories of, well, you're talking about the year when you were playing. And
anytime, had, even the 70s.
We both only had, we needed an extra game. I said, "Well, Coz, let's just play twice." So we played Bethel the first game, and they beat us fairly good. And we were very young. By the time we got to them last game, we'd aged up a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
Beat them pretty good. I think Hotshot went from 200 yards rushing the first game to 10 yards the second game.
Right, right.
Because
right.
Lumpkins hit him upside the head.
Man.
At the second play, I looked at the film. Somebody said, "What's he doing?" I looked at Mike, looked like Mike Tyson.
Hey, Coach, the first game that year, I was on the varsity roster, but I didn't want to dress out because I knew I wasn't going to get in the game. But the second game, the JV season was over. I had moved up. And, Coach, that's one of my fondest memories of high school football. The opening kickoff of the second game, Coach, we're kicking off, and your two deep men are Leslie Bailey and Linwood Lumpkins. And I'm on the kickoff team. And I said, "You know what? I said, I'm just do what I'm supposed to do. I'm going to stay in my lane." We kicked it deep, and the ball went to Leslie Bailey. And I said, "Oh, good. He was running that way, and he ran to the left, and I was to the right or vice versa. But he was running to his left, and I said, oh, I'm going to stay in my lane." Everybody went over there. He cut back, and it was just me and Leslie. And I was like, I put my head down, and we hit. I thought he was going to run me over. We balanced out, went down. And, Coach, the only thing I wanted to do was get up and hear my name on the loudspeaker because I was a 10th grader, and I heard him say Rusty Byrd with a tackle. But the next thing I said is, I was seeing stars. I didn't want to go to the wrong sideline. I turned, I found the Bethel. I was closer to y'all, Coach. I almost went to your sideline. I made it to the Bethel sideline, and that was my 10th grade game against Hampton. We didn't kick off anymore.
Hey, that's Matt Boone. Matt Boone, you remember Matt Boone at Denby?
Yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah.
Oh, one of my favorite people, Matt Boone and Teddy Baco. They were so funny. They were great guys. They were great friends. And Matt Boone used to call Leslie Bailey Gorilla Man.
Yeah.
He said, "Don't call Gorilla Man next week, Coach."
And then he went to
when it was really fun.
Oh, and yeah.
Of course, they talked about Coz. Coz had. I remember Coz, one of my best memories about Coz was Coz had a kid that played for him. And then the pretty good football player. And the kid got himself declared his. To where he was his own guardian. I mean, he was
right.
Oh, yeah.
And so he comes to Hampton, enrolls himself in school, and goes the whole second semester. And football season coming up second semester, and We always had a peninsula meeting with the ADs, the principals, and the coaches. And I'm telling Kaz, I said, Kaz, you know, that boy's going back to Bethel. I say he's ineligible. At that time, the HSS was real strong on that.
Right.
Yep.
Kaz, he's ineligible. Kaz just ignored it. They played him first game.
I know. That was my tip
and for you. Called the principal over there, and Bethel had won, and he had to forfeit the game.
We had to forfeit.
But I was trying to help him, because Matt Boone and Teddy Becko said, no, 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 let him play about eight games. We make
it. That's right.
At the end of the year, we're playing Kaz, and I called Kaz up that Sunday morning. I said, Kaz, want to trade films? He said, don't believe I do. Slam the phone.
Coach, I remember that player. My first year there. Yes, it was, man. I remember it. We were like, we got to forfeit. Gosh, we had to forfeit that game, man. But yeah, those were some good days.
But you know, I said, I don't want to go halfway through the season after forfeit.
Yeah.
But they were real strong. And now you can go where you want to go. High schools are kind of like the transfer portal in college. Now.
Like college. That's right.
Yeah. It's a lot easier now. Hey, Coach, I wanted to touch on one of the things that we talked about on the telephone, and you had a lot of stability there with Coach Alvis Mann and Danny Mitchell, and they were with you for the long haul for a very long time.
And another guy, Bob Tyson, was with me.
Right. Okay. Just talk about that coaching core in the decades, you know, that went over and having that staff, you know, in place for all those years.
It was those guys did more coaching than I did, brother. They just loved the game. They loved the school. They loved the kids. It was great. I mean, and anymore, you know, it's one of the difficult things, and I was talking to my friend, called me about a month ago from Texas. That was the head of the Texas Coaches Association. And he said they were having a terrible time to getting coaches in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, you know, this is difficult in Virginia also. I don't think they have as much difficulty in the southwestern part of the state.
Right.
Because you still have those guys coaching that are in the schools. Mm-hmm. But as you come east, north.
And right, north, yep.
Yep.
You find that you just don't have coaches in the schools to
coach. Right. Yep. Yeah, a lot of that.
That's important. Mm-hmm. I think it's vital that the head coach particularly be in the school.
In the school. Absolutely.
And at that time, I was there, Alvis was there, Danny was there, and then when Bob Tyson coached with us, he was there. So it was strong because you stayed in contact with your kids.
Right.
It's like a big family.
Coach, one of the things that everybody knows about you is that you were ahead of your time. Before computers, you studied the game. You know, you did a lot of charting, you knew the formations, you looked at tendencies, and this is all from, you know, watching film and taking notes and, you know, probably ahead of a lot of guys now. Talk to us and our viewers about, because everybody's like, you know, Mike Smith, you won so much because you were such a precision guy and studied the game and knew your opponents. How did that come about? And tell us a little bit about, you know, doing that way back when.
I think it started when I was assistant coach.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, I coached with Johnny Palmer. There's never been a greater guy to coach with, but there's never been a guy that hated watching film as bad as Johnny did. Johnny Palmer, you go scout a game from the stands. I've never seen a person anywhere that could sit right and see what he saw. Wow. But when he came to watch the film, he didn't want do that. So I always charted the film, and it became a passion of mine. And I think as I remember back, one of the toughest times, we were playing Coach Charlie Nuttercombe from Minchfield.
Mm-hmm. Minchfield, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Years ago. And he had developed a system where they were on offense, you would think they were running 50 different formations. But honest to goodness, I stayed up for 3 days watching those films. That's the old real type film. Mm-hmm. And finally, I realized they only had 3 sets.
Right.
Hey, but we had prepared for all of them. We go playing, he runs 1 set. I said, Coach, I spent all that time preparing. He said, I know. But I knew you was going to do that. So we just ran the 1. So I think that was the big thing. I always try to find a team's weakness and make them play left-handed if they were right-handed. If you have to get a left-handed guy, you were in trouble. But always try to make them play left-handed. Take their best 3 best plays away. And back in the old days, they weren't pass plays because the only thing you saw was the boot. And then in recent years, people started running the spread, but it wasn't any different. First time we played against the spread, I think when was it Beasley that was coaching over at Lansdowne?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He's done a really good job. He's in the pros now.
Yeah.
So Chris.
Tyrod, yeah, Chris Beatty. And so Tyrod Taylor was a ninth grader. And we go playing, and they had that wide receiver that was so
Harvin. Good. Percy Harvin.
Percy Harvin.
But it didn't take me long to figure out. They weren't running verticals. You know, they weren't running 4 verticals. They were running hitches. It was catch and run.
Right.
So learned that pretty soon. But also, I don't know, you play different people. I think the big change going from the I formation was when everybody wanted to run the wishbone.
Mm-hmm.
I think we developed a system to close that down pretty well.
Run the I know. I was the foreman. Coach, can I just say one thing, Coach? I want to point this out. I love Coach Cos. I love the staff and everything. But I will say one of the things I noticed, and I've coached youth football and middle school football over the last couple of years. But, you know, I love Coach Cos. But one of the things he would do was try to implement something new this week and then something new the next week. And I know, and I was talking to Jason Wallace. We just had him on the show. I think before we played you, we had played Denby, and he came out. We had 2 different offenses. We had the passing offense with Kent Johnson throwing the ball, and then Melendez and like Roger Carrison, that running back, and they passed the ball. Then when Jason went in, we ran the wishbone. So it was Jason at quarterback, me at fullback, William Beverly, and I think Michael Dulo, my brother. It worked to perfection against Denby. But all you needed to see it on film was 1 time, and we tried that. My senior year, that's when 86, it was like 4 teams had a chance to win the district. And it was like you guys, Phoebus, us, I think Warwick, even Denby had a great season. And man, you stopped us. It was like you knew what you were doing. But the thing I give you guys credit for is you didn't change a lot. You did your system and you perfected it. Like I could tell your, and I always say that about him, I was like, Hampton, you guys had your system. It evolved over the years, but you perfected it. If you ran this sweep, or that was whatever you were running, like you ran it, and I could tell you perfected it. And even if we knew it was coming, we couldn't stop it sometimes. So I give you a lot of credit, Coach. I could tell your system and the way you did it I don't know. Maybe you changed everything every week. I don't know. But it, to me, it just seemed like you guys knew what you were doing.
Well, I think probably with defense, we always thought with the option, with the veer and with the wishbone, never let the quarterback get outside the offensive tackle with the ball in his hand. As Cos would say, don't ever let him get to Hero's Alley.
That's right. Yep, yep.
That's what we said. Don't let him get to Hero's Alley. And but we were able to do that, and we got tied up with started playing the wing T against the wing T, and we had that figured out pretty good. So, and we've done, I think we've done a good job with the spread offense. There were certain things you had to do, I think, to stop that. Right now, I think Beavis does a good job, but I think maybe they probably got a few things that we used to do. And but someone worried about Beavis going down playing in state championship game this year against the team down in Lynchburg.
Liberty Christian, yeah.
They said, well, that's not going to be fair. Liberty Christian recruits us. I started laughing.
I know what you
said. I said, they could learn from Phoebus, I guarantee you. Every year we go over there, I'd be looking over there at five guys that played for me last year that I said, keep playing them all. The quarterback played for him this year, played for me for 2 years, and Mama got mad because he wasn't starting, took him to Phoebus. I had a quarterback before, and both times they won the state championship. But, you know, it is what it is, but they've done a good job with them. So, hey, you know, that's where they want to go. They can't follow the rules that I've got, then they got to go somewhere.
Okay. I feel you.
Coach, speaking of players, I mean, with over 50 years, man, you've had some amazing players, and I was talking to Coach Newsome earlier, and you know, I've watched you interviewed before. This is a little more of an informal talk, but you know, most of the time you don't want to ask a coach who's the best player you ever coached. But I think I know your answer, and I think it's clear. But two questions, and I'll ask them. Who's the best player you ever coached? And talk about just the incredible players that you've had since 1970. And I'm going to let you answer, but I totally agree with the best player to ever play high school football played for you.
First of all, somebody said success. And my theory on that is that no one ever won the Derby on a mule.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right. And we've had some great
yes, sir.
Your first question, and I don't think there'll ever be another one, Ron Kirk.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
And I think one of the things that a lot of people didn't, and most people didn't understand about him was he's like a computer. He's super intelligent. He was outstanding on both sides of the ball.
Right.
But going past that, I mean, one of the first great ones was a kid by the name of Alex Hill, who was a running back. He was a tremendous player.
What year was that, Coach? What year was Alex Hill?
1970, 71.
Okay, yeah.
A guy named Teddy Powell. Teddy Powell played when I was an assistant coach my last year. And Teddy Powell went to Ohio State. He's deceased now. He was such a great player. Lamont Hope, who went to Tennessee. We've had so many.
Yeah, I know you've had
quarterbacks. We had Ronald.
Right.
The year before I had Ronald, I had Lisa, who was my quarterback.
No, the one that went to Purdue got killed.
Eric Hunter.
Eric's great.
Big guy.
Yeah, he was great.
Big guy. Yep.
And I tell you what, his first 2 years at Purdue, he broke every record there was, and they changed coach and messed him up. So I was so fortunate to have him, and then I had Ronald, and then I had one that was a half a step maybe behind Ronald by the name of Marcus Higgins.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Great player.
Great. And what a great – and he played football when he was 14, 15, 16.
Mm-hmm.
Football when he was 13 at Bethlehem. He stayed half a practice, went through the woods and never went back. Came to Hampton. He played basketball.
He could play some basketball, yeah.
Played basketball over as a 10th grader or 9th grader, whatever it was. And came to Hampton and going to play football. And Coach Fannin took me in. I didn't know Marcus. And introduced me to Marcus. And I talked to him. I said, I'll tell you what. Come out for football. Give me 2 weeks. If you're not happy. So after 2 days, you couldn't run him off. So we had them, and then we had Marcus. I mean, Tyrod.
Right.
Tyrod, yeah.
Boy, I had a run of some great ones there.
Yep.
Great kids, great players. Robert Banks, what a tremendous player.
That goes back to our younger days. Parade All-American, going to Notre Dame, like superstar, rock star.
And what a great guy.
Mm-hmm.
Has been tremendous, tremendous individual today.
Did you coach Dwight Stevenson?
Bruce Massenburg, as I had mentioned him earlier.
Right, yep.
Great player. Great two-way player. And I saw the other night there, the guy that old Kirk had over there, Gerard Mayo. I hope he gets that job. I don't know if they've
had
Denver. That's Denver.
He's a great.
Yeah.
He's a good one, buddy.
Yeah. I hope he gets it too. Yeah.
But, Coach, I want to ask you, not only did you have a lot of great players, of course, they had great coaching, but like you said, it takes great players. But how about the players that you played against in the last 50 years, not only down in the Tidewater, Peninsula District, Southside, you faced some great, great football players. How about some of the players you played against? I mean, guys in the Hall of Fame.
Bubba Chuck Iverson.
I'm going to say Allen Iverson.
Bubba Chuck.
Wearing that green.
Unbelievable.
I'm surprised you ain't still out one from us.
Bubba Chuck with number 10. Hey, we're playing Bubba Chuck. And I had one of the best football players I ever coached named Meyer Newsom.
Yeah.
But
Foster
says he's the best defensive player ever coached in his life.
Could fly.
We're playing the game. And I'm sending a play in. I hear somebody get the play in, coach. I'm tired of waiting on you. Get the play in. I look at it, Bubba Chuck. He's standing on the ass or the numbers hollering. I love old Bubba Chuck over here. I tell you what, he was a tough kid, boy. Anybody that can raise herself on the street and do what he did, I've got nothing but admiration for him.
Yeah.
But we played against them. We played against Aaron Brooks. We played against Mike Tomlin.
Yeah.
Michael Vick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Dwight Hollier.
Dwight's brother played for me.
Yeah,
he Darnell. Played for you. Yes, Darnell.
Right. Yep.
Yeah,
that's right.
Darnell, a really good player. And when we had Darnell, we had Bobby Blizzard.
Yep.
Bobby Blizzard. Yep. Beast.
Old Muffin.
Yeah.
Muffin Curry. Yeah.
He was. We've had so many. It's just hard to remember them all, and the ones.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
We play against there have been so many good ones come off this peninsula. Both the DB boys were great players.
Yeah, from Phoebus, yep.
Yeah, DB. I think. I saw him going back. Is he going to Tech to coach?
Yeah, Tech hired him yesterday as a defensive analyst. So
he's a good – they were really good, a good young man.
Yeah, Taj Boyd and then, you know, your Ray Savage.
We played against Taj when he came in a little bit there when we went over to scrimmage Lansdowne when Coach Beatty was over. We went over to scrimmage him. And Taj Boyd transferred out of there. He was fresh at the time, I guess.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah.
So he came on this side of water. He wanted to come to Hampton, but Tyrod was just a – Tyrod would be playing the next year, and he wanted to play, so they took him to
– Right.
I never really knew him until he – Yeah, Terry Kirby and Slade.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. That's right. You did play them. Yep.
Taj Boyd's a nice kid, though. I met him in – one of Mike Tomlin's functions.
Mm-hmm.
Just a tremendous, nice young person. I kind of thought he might end up going to Virginia with a new coach, but I guess he didn't.
Hey, Coach, let me ask you something. So you have done a lot. I mean, you've won over 500 games, 12 state championships. Weren't you also instrumental in the VHSL Virginia High
Coaches Association,
the All-Star game?
Yeah.
And the All-Star game, right.
Executive director, have been for the last, 20 years or so.
Mm-hmm.
Been executive director and, coaching has changed somewhat, just like the players, I think, over the years. I remember the guys like Willis White from Salem and
all
the guys over the years. And, of course, one of my truly great friends right now and retired from coaching at Powell Valley is up at UVA-Y, Phil Robbins.
That's right. That's right. We were talking about him, Coach.
Oh, hey, he's a guy you need to get on this fight. I tell you what, I know. Hey, Phil Robbins knows everybody that ever played football, everybody that ever officiated football.
We'll talk to him.
Coach football in Virginia. And, you know, Kurt Newsom. I remember old Kurt called me years ago. Kurt said, Coach, you mind if I come over and watch you guys practice? We were getting ready for the playoffs. We were going to the playoffs about every year then. I said, sure. But if you're going to come and watch, you got to go up in the booth and help every game.
Put him to work.
Yeah.
I'll put him to work. Somebody said, you better watch. He going to come back and get you. He'll come back and be beat. Well, it wasn't long before I started looking across the field. And it looked like I was looking in a mirror. So.
Oh, Coach Smith is so funny because I was talking to him earlier this evening to prepare for this interview. And he goes, don't you dare say that I went over there, went up in the booth and helped them, but you let the cat out of the bag right there. Yeah, the kicking tail season was over. He was up in the booth helping you.
And he was good up there. He,
damn right. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hey, yes, sir. I tell you what, I take a little bit of credit for old Kurt. Great guy, great coach. Our son played for him over at Kickatan for you.
Right.
And he moved on and then he called me and he was interviewing, and I think the guy Wood at JMU was
ready
to hire Kurt, and they fired him. So Kurt calls me up and he asked me, do I know Mickey?
Matthews.
Mickey Matthews. I said, yeah, I know Mickey, honey. Coaching up Marshall and defensive coordinator down at Georgia.
That's right. Georgia.
I said, I know Mickey. And he just taken defensive coordinator's job at Baylor.
Mm-hmm.
Would you call him for me? I said, I sure will, Kirk, because I wanted to get him out of my hair.
Yeah.
I said, that's a way to get rid of him.
That's right. That's how you do it. And out.
I don't know. Oh, I call old Mickey up. He's out practice. Come back, but Mickey called me. Mickey and I had a pretty good relationship. So we start talking. He said, well, Coach, he's never coached at college. He said, you got to be able to recruit. And I said, Mickey, when he left Kickatan, he had 17 guys that had addresses that nobody could confirm. They weren't even anywhere near Kickatan. So
That's PO boxes. That's PO boxes. That sounds like Coach Newsom.
He could out recruit anybody in the don't worry about that. So we get on that road a bit. He said, well, old Kurt, back at that time, Kurt was making maybe like 38 or something. You know, things, you weren't getting a lot of money back then. 38, 39, something. He said, well, I tell you what, said, you know, I'm kind of limited on budget. Said, I can't pay but so much. I said, I think you can get him for 50 grand. Next thing I know, Kurt's up there.
Yep.
He's up in Harrisonburg.
Right.
And goodness, when I was in Daytona Beach for a national clinic, and my wife went up after our son graduated from Virginia, went up and played at JMU 1 year when they won the national championship. But they were having a banquet, and she went with Brian, and she said all they talked about was Coach Newsom. he's a tremendous coach. He's a player's coach.
Yeah.
Good guy.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, it's interesting, over the span of 50 years, we're going back, and I think about the coaches that have come by and the assistants that are recruited. I mean, we're talking Ohio State, Notre Dame.
Woody Hayes.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to ask. Who, just take us down memory lane of greatness, because, you know, good old Hampton High School on Queen Street has had football royalty come by there. Talk about guys coming by there. And by the way, what kind of impression did they make on you, Coach? Now, I don't want you to dig yourself in a hole, but you know, tell us some interesting stuff.
I always tell it like it is.
Exactly. That's what I was about to say.
We had Woody Hayes come by. I liked old Woody, but he was a little bit crazy sometimes to the players. But he was a good guy. I like Woody. He was tough. Tom Osborne, so mm-hmm. soft.
Wow.
Such nice guy. Super nice guy. Tennessee.
Phil Fulmer.
Oh, Don DeVoe.
No, Johnny Majors.
Johnny Majors. Johnny Majors. Yeah, Johnny Majors.
I saw Johnny Majors play when I was in high school. He was tailback
right.
Tennessee. Yeah, single for Tennessee. Band. That's right.
Yeah, that's a long time ago. And they beat Dayton 55-0. But anyhow, Majors there. Phillip's with him. I've known Phillip a long time. I've known both of them.
Right.
So they decide they want to go jogging. After we had our guys in lifting his offseason. They were recruiting a couple of kids we had. We had one big tackle went down there. So we go running. We go from Hampton High School, run about 3 miles. Well, I'm out front. Danny's out front. Phillip's up with us. And Majors, Alvis is staying back. The Alvis man staying back with Majors. Make sure he's okay. I hear wheels squealing. They go across Pembroke. Alvis got to pull him across. They almost got run over. Hey, can you see the headlines? Majors run.
Johnny's run.
On Pembroke Avenue. So, but old Johnny Majors. So they all been back. One of my favorite people was old George when he was at Virginia.
George Welch, yeah.
Great program.
George Welch's a great guy. And wait a minute now, I've been on here so long. Coach at Richmond, when Kenny went up there in 75. Jim Tate.
Yep.
What a great guy. Mm-hmm. He'd never been better one of him. Hank Norton down at Fern Junior College.
Yep.
One of the best coaches ever been around.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, Coach.
These are tremendous guys that were coaching, you know, just, I know I should say Beamer, but Beamer and I butted heads a couple of times. But you know what? Hey, old boy, I think the best compliment I ever had from coaching about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I got a call from school. They said, there's two coaches out here. Won't you come by and see you? Can you come by? I said, who is it? They said, Phil Elmation.
Oh, yeah.
Wade Brooks. I said, I'll be there in 10 minutes. So we go down and talk. Phil Elmation is coach. I think Phil coached in 25, 26 different colleges.
Right. UVA and Tech.
I tell you what he did. He kept Frank Beamer's job for him at Tech.
Right.
Oh, wow.
Absolutely.
He was putting him on roller skates. Elmation went in and put that defense in. And mm-hmm.
That's right.
I appreciate Bud. Elmation put that defense in.
I think my brother said that. Yep.
And that's true. But you know where you got that defense?
Where?
You say that. There you go.
Hey, Elmo. And wait, do you ever know Waverly Brooks? Oh, Waverly was from New Kent. And then he ends up going to Virginia coaching. And then he's with Sonny Randall at Marshall.
Right.
Good guy. Comes back and gets out of coaching, goes back and has a seafood restaurant up in Williamsburg. But Elmation had retired. And so I go out there and I talk to him. I know they're an hour and a half. Elmation paid me the best compliment I've ever had coaching. And he used to come by school all the time. And old Phil played for Hank Norton at Ferrum. He loved Hank Norton. And after Ferrum, he went to William and Mary.
Mm-hmm.
And then he coached everywhere, Washington, Virginia. Virginia Tech, Minnesota, Arkansas. But we sat down, we talked, and after a long time, he said, you know, I used to love to come here. I used to love to come to practice. And that was back in the mid-70s. We had guys that hit you so hard, you could hear it downtown Richmond somewhere. He said, you know, I've coached 25, 26 colleges. I've been to all these spring clinics and colleges. I've recruited all these high schools, been at practice. And he said, I'm not blowing smoke. He said, but I want to tell you, the best practices I've ever been at were practices out here behind this school.
Wow.
And he said, every time I walked away, he said, I felt like I was a better coach. So, you know, probably the greatest compliment I've ever had.
Yep.
But coach, what a coach he was, boy. Elmation was. But the thing about Elmation, he's like the mange on the dog. He would move from one place to another. You know, he was a defensive coordinator at Boston College. And that's when they got – the head coach got a little something, but he's coached everywhere.
I think he has a radio show in Roanoke now, Coach. I'm pretty sure he does. Coach, your video went off. See if it's okay. There we go. Yeah, I think he's got a radio show in Roanoke.
Hold on just a second, please. Okay. He's retired in Myrtle Beach now. I think he just got married again. I don't know how many times. He got no way to put up with it too. He's a great guy. I love Phil M. Mason. Long meaning guy from Boston. Tough one, boy. He was a tough one. Mm-hmm.
Hey, Coach, one of the things I know what you are to a lot of people. So, we did this show because there are a lot of great players that come out of your program, professionals, big time college players. But Coach, it's not just those players. To me, one of your greatest impact are so many guys that have just been great men, great contributors to the community. You know, I mean, I look at the guys I grew up with, I went to elementary school with, and there's just so many doing so well. I mean, I know the Stan Jones, Sherwood Jones. I know, DeRocky Kroom, and these are guys I played with, you know, or played directly against, and they're just such great contributors to the community. Coach, that to me, that's what a lot of this is more about, like that mentor. Like, you may not have officially been called title mentor, but beyond coaching, you have mentored great. You've taken boys and made great men, and I think that's, to me, one of your greatest contributions to the city of Hampton, to the Peninsula District, Coach, because you, like Coach Cause, where that, you know, I didn't understand it at the time, but I look back, some of my, our friends, we look, and like everybody didn't go to college and play major football, but so many of us are, we survived his two-a-days. We survived the Hampton Bethel game. Like, and that made, that I carried that with me. And so, Coach, I just want to say, you know, I am grateful for the impact I know you've had on so many of my dear friends, and the way you've, like, the, over these 50 years, the 12 state championships are awesome. But to me, the thousands of young men that you've developed into men, I think that's great. And so I want to say, I know you're a great mentor, but can I ask you this? And I'll let you address, you know, the fact you've been, but would you say you have any specific mentors in your life that you can look back on? But I want to just say, you have been a great mentor to many, many, many people.
You know, my father probably more than anybody. My father was, I've always thought was the smartest man I ever knew. He was an electrician. He was worked for the Tennessee, the Holston Defense was, he went up as a foreman and a supervisor. But with my father, there wasn't, I always, and I still believe it, there wasn't anything he couldn't do. Nothing he couldn't figure out. Mm-hmm. He had great patience, a lot more patience than I did, but I learned that from him, you know. But I always said that sometimes the manager on the team may be more important than the star player. Right. We never treated anyone differently. Sure. Never. I mean, from if you were the head of the, of course they call them scout squad, we call them the meat squad.
Meat squad.
Meat squad.
Coach, I was with the meat squad in 10th grade. Hold on, Coach. I got to say this. When we prepared for the Hampton Bethel game my 10th grade year and I moved up to varsity, I had to be Linwood Lumpkins and Terrell Britt, D.D. Van, Creighton and Comenius, Mickey and Comenius, Carl Barkers. I get the ball. They were like, get Linwood Lumpkins. And, man, they tore me up. So I know about meat squad.
I think when they grabbed Linwood, they had a fight on their hand.
It wasn't me. They could tell the difference.
I tell you what, some of the guys that never or seldom got in the game, to me, were some of the most important people on our team.
Right.
They were there every day. They worked. Great attitudes. And so, I always had the philosophy that unless there's some redeeming social values in football, why play the game?
Right.
It's a teaching tool.
You know, yes, it's a discipline. It's and it carries over from the football field into the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. a lot of people never understood that in schools. But I read an article once, and I'd like to go back and find it somewhere. But it contributed to the fact that coaching on the football field was the best teaching tool that these kids ever had.
Yeah.
But they found a place that they fit in, they can achieve, they realize they can learn, and they know that you love them, and it carries over to the classroom, and it carries over to adulthood. So you just talked about DeRocky Croom, who is the assistant director for Parks and Recs here in City Hampton. Tremendous young man.
Yes.
And I think the director of athletics in the city of Hampton probably going to do it one more year. And I would think probably DeRocky probably be in that position. Mm-hmm. He's a great guy, DeRocky.
Yes, sir.
Hey, but all these guys, I mean, the Bethel guys, you know, I've been working with a friend of mine now at my attorney. My attorney went to Bethel High School. Steve
Ford. He's a good man.
For wrestling. I tell you what, buddy. He's about akin to a bulldog as you could throw in the ring. He is a good one. Yeah. He's a great guy.
Well, look, Coach, we've had you on for a while. It's getting late. We really appreciate it. And, you know, you've made a huge difference. And, wow, you know, having the third winningest coach in U.S. history in our hometown and all the great memories, like, you know, fifth, sixth grade. I think the statute of limitations has ran out, but I jumped over that brick wall a couple times when I couldn't get a ticket. And, you know, and everybody turned into a crabber in the playoffs. You know, everybody was rooting for Hampton, and, you know, 5 out of 10 state championships in the 80s. And you were also runner up a couple times, but it's been quite a journey. But I think you pointed it out.
I just want to say one thing before, and I'll let you go to the person, but Coach, I don't know who Darling was. It's been Darling Stadium, but I would say one of the things I'd like to see them do is, even if they keep Darling Stadium, I would like to see your name on that stadium, sir. So it may be if it's Smith Field or Darling Stadium Smith, but I think, you know, I truly believe that your name should be represented on that stadium very, very soon.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate that. But, you know, that those things don't – it's the love of the guys. And I cannot believe the – it's just like you guys tonight. I can't believe the impact that people's had in their talking to me and messages. So, in the spring – and I've got to get a date in either May or late April or early May. I'm going to have a big cookout for 2 days, Daniel. I got a big cooker. I got a guy that can use it here. I've got it parked down here. Cook 500 pounds of meat at the time. I'm going to have a 2-day and invite everybody there to play football at Hampton. And then if anybody else wants to come that play for Bethel.
I know Bruin that wants to go. Hey, look, I was supposed to go there. Coach.
Yo, guys, hey, I'm going to get the date to you. I'd like for you to come. Go around and do
you. I was there. Nobody would have ever heard of Robbie Robinson if I had been there. it would have been me. Coach, it would have been me. Nobody would ever heard of Robbie Robinson. Coach, it would have been me.
Hey, you know, I ran Robbie Robinson off when he was in the 10th grade. Hey.
Oh, you did?
It's in 10th grade. He was still playing JV. My dad came up to visit. I said, that's when I realized he was still a whole lot smarter than me. And Robbie Robinson's out there running on JV. Didn't want to play varsity. Wanted to play JV that year. I said, I'm not even going to let him play next year. My dad said, son, don't cut your nose off Spike's face, man.
Robbie was a beast. So Robbie Robinson.
Yeah, he was that.
Make sure you listen to this. Well, look, Coach, we look forward to seeing you down on the beach. Thank you for everything that you've done. I know a lot of people are going to watch this, and I can tell you that I've talked to coaches around the state, as well as players in the area down there that did not play for you, that came to you for help, and you gladly helped them. So, you know, maybe things weren't going right, and you sent out film, your film, not necessarily their film. So you've impacted a lot of people's lives, and it's such a, you know, we talk to coaches up here, and they're like, you set the gold standard. You start at the All-Star game, the Coaches Association. So, you know, we want to close out. Thank you so much. We look forward to seeing you. Thank you for coming on the show. It's the Kirk and Byrd Show on YouTube for all the folks watching. Would like for you to subscribe, and we're going to have new people on. But, Coach, thank you so much. It was just so much fun.
You have really blessed us, Coach. Thank you.
Oh, you guys, thank you so much. I've enjoyed it so much. Send me a text and let me know how people can check it out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
yes, yes, sir.
Yeah, Coach, I'll take care of you. I'll send you an email and a text, and
with a link to it and everything.
Yep, yep. And you know, you can share it. Make sure Alvis Mann gets it. He'll remember me.
Alvis Mann. What a good
guy. Yeah. But Coach,
Alvis Mann, one of the greatest people ever walked on this earth. And I tell you another great one is a guy that worked for me this year, is Kenny Gilliam.
Yeah, I've heard of him. Yeah, okay.
Kenny coached with me for 30 years. Played in the 75 team with Dwight Stevenson.
Right.
And Woody Wilson and those guys. Well, guys, I appreciate it. I've enjoyed it.
Thank you so much,
Thank
Coach.
Thank you, Coach. It's an honor to have you on. We love
Who's
it.
Who's your brother now?
Melendez, he's a professor at Norfolk State. He ended up getting his master's and PhD from Virginia Tech, and he's a college professor at Norfolk State.
I've got an old boy that's just made All-American over last year. He's got one more year.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Nice. Yeah.
Okay. And I will tell you this, Coach. My brother has loved your Crabble players, and he was mentored to Dwight Vick, who lives up here in Prince William County with me. And again, that's another one of those guys. Just a great human being. So awesome. Thanks again, Coach. I will definitely tell my mom, my dad, my parents own Lewis Driving, used to own Lewis Driving School. My pop, Bland Lewis, and my mom, Jackie Lewis, they were both PE teachers in Hampton City Schools around your age. And so everybody loved you, and we just want to thank you again, man.
Hey, I thank you guys. Thank you.
All right. Great, Coach.
All right. Take care.
God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. You're the